It's the serial killer many of you have been waiting for, the one who so cruelly taught the importance of a secure home. This week we discuss the Night Stalker himself, Richard Ramirez. Let's open the serial killer file. Richard was born in El Paso, Texas in 1960, the youngest of five siblings. His father was a Mexican national and a former policeman from Juarez. He worked hard on the Santa Fe Railroad, but would occasionally have violent outbursts, which led to extensive abuse. Aside from this, Richard seemed to be a bit accident-prone. He sustained two serious head injuries as a child, once when a dresser fell on him and lacerated his head, and another when a swing at the park struck him so hard it knocked him unconscious. Richard began to experience frequent epileptic seizures that would continue to plague him into his early teen years. Things took an especially dark turn when Richard began to spend time with his older cousin Miguel. Miguel was a veteran of the Green Berets and would often brag about his most gruesome experiences during the Vietnam War. A sick, twisted man, he would show Richard photos he had taken of people he had killed or women he had raped. Some of the photos featured Miguel holding the severed head of a woman he had sexually abused. The two took their relationship a step further when Miguel began teaching Richard military skills, including stealth and kill tactics. Richard began avoiding his father and spending his nights sleeping in cemeteries. Miguel's influence over Richard continued. One day, Miguel shot his wife Jessie in the face with a .38 caliber revolver after an argument. Richard was present and witnessed the entire thing. The murder shut him down, to a sense. He began to withdraw from others. Miguel pled insanity and was released after spending 4 years in a mental hospital. Richard moved in later with his older sister and her husband, who was an obsessive peeping Tom, and would take Richard on night rides with him, where they would both peek in people's windows and search for women undressing. During this time, Richard began to delve into LSD and Satanism. As time went on, the line between Richard's corrupt introduction to sexuality and his experiences with violence began to blur. Richard ended up taking a job at a Holiday Inn. He used his passkey to access people's rooms and steal from them while they were asleep. He was eventually fired when a man returned to his room one night to find Richard attempting to rape his wife. He beat Richard terribly, but due to the fact that he was from out of state and not wishing to return for a trial, the couple refused to testify against him and the criminal charges were dropped. Richard dropped out of school and at the age of 22 moved to California. But Richard's future was destined to become much, much worse. On April 10th, 1984, the Night Stalker was officially born. It was then that Richard's first known killing came to light. A 9-year-old girl was found murdered in a hotel basement where Richard had been living in San Francisco. The girl had been beaten, raped, and stabbed until dead. Her body was strung up carelessly on a pipe. The next victim was found on June 28, 1984. She was 79 years old and was found brutally stabbed to death while she had been asleep. Her throat was then cut so severely that she had almost been decapitated. In March of 1985, Richard attacked a 22-year-old woman as she pulled into her garage by shooting at her face. Thankfully, the bullet ricocheted off her keys when she raised her hands to protect herself, and she survived. Her roommate heard the gunshot and hid, but Richard found her and shot her in the head, killing her instantly. Richard wasn't done, however. Within an hour following the murder, Richard pulled a 30-year-old woman out of her car in Monterey Park and shot her twice before fleeing. She died upon arriving at the hospital. The incredibly bold and outrageous criminal acts sparked much media attention. But the Night Stalker was only getting started. 10 days later, Richard broke into a home at around 2 a.m. and shot a 64-year-old man while he slept. His wife was awakened by the noise, and Richard beat her repeatedly before tying her up and demanding to know where her valuables were. While searching the room, the woman managed to escape her binds and grabbed her husband's shotgun. It wasn't loaded. This enraged Richard, who shot her three times and then retrieved a large carving knife from the kitchen. The woman's body was mercilessly mutilated. Her eyes had been gouged out and placed in a jewelry box. Richard took the box with him. The two victims were discovered by their son. Police examined the bullets and were able to confirm a match between them and ones found at previous crime scenes. They then knew a serial killer was on the loose. But aside from the bullets, some footprints, and a rough description from one single survivor, police didn't have too much to go on. But Richard seemed to. He continued to invade people's homes at night, murdering, raping, stealing. Most of the victims were elderly. He'd sneak his way in and explode into violence, shooting people in the head, bludgeoning them with hammers, shocking them with electrical cords in order to torture them. Oddly enough, Richard would at times leave his victims alive. One such instance was after he beat a 16-year-old girl with a tire iron while she slept. He couldn't find a knife, so he began strangling her with a telephone cord. The cord sparked and surprised Richard. Once his victim began to breathe again, he took it as a sign of divine intervention by Jesus Christ and fled. She required nearly 500 stitches to close up the wounds he gave her. If he would let anyone live, it almost always be after a severe beating and sometimes vicious raping. He would take from them everything of value. And if the victim claimed that they had nothing left for him to take, he'd make them swear on Satan. At a few crime scenes, Richard would use lipstick to scrawl pentagrams on the walls or on victims' bodies. The media was in a frenzy over the murders, and the mayor at the time made a crucial error. Richard often left footprints at scenes. The mayor, Dianne Feinstein, leaked sensitive information to the public via a press conference, which infuriated detectives. They knew Richard would have been following media coverage. And they were right. Richard, that very night, dropped his shoes off the edge of the Golden Gate Bridge and hid out for a few days before returning back to Los Angeles, where he invaded another man's home. He shot him in the head three times, but miraculously, the man survived. The man's fiancée was present, and Richard introduced himself as the Night Stalker. She was bound and beaten and forced to swear her love for Satan before she was raped and sodomized, like so many victims before her. He left her alive and escaped in one of his many stolen cars. This time, however, a 13-year-old neighbor noticed the suspicious figure and wrote down most of the license plate number. The car was eventually found abandoned, and police were able to lift one single fingerprint from the rearview mirror, aside from the fact that Richard was often meticulous about wiping any vehicle down of fingerprints first. The print led to a positive identification of the suspect who had been in trouble with drugs in the past. Richard's face was now plastered everywhere, but due to the fact Richard was out of the state to meet up with his brother, he had no idea. Upon his return, he casually walked up to a convenience store and noticed a group of elderly women referring to him as the killer. Richard looked down to find his own face on the newspaper rack by him and fled in panic. There was nowhere left for Richard to hide. Everyone knew exactly who he was. He attempted a number of carjackings after being chased down by residents. He was struck over the head with a metal bar eventually and pinned down until police arrived. And the Night Stalker had been caught. In perhaps one of the most famous moments of all serial killer history, Richard held up a hand with a pentagram drawn on it and exclaimed, "Hail Satan," at his first court appearance. On September 20th, 1989, Richard Ramirez was convicted of 13 counts of murder, 5 attempted murders, 11 sexual assaults, and 14 burglaries. He was sentenced to die in the gas chamber, to which Richard scoffed and replied, "Big deal. Death always went with the territory. See you in Disneyland." Richard Ramirez was in his mid-20s when he was caught and died at the age of 53 in 2013, not from the gas chamber, but from B-cell lymphoma. It's believed he wouldn't have been executed until he was well into his 70s due to the lengthy process of appeals. That's all in this file. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe to my channel now by either clicking on screen or below this video. See you next time.